Everyone, Michael Antonovich with Swapmoto Live, bringing you this pre-race news break for the 2022 Anaheim 2 Supercross.
It's always fun to be at Angel Stadium, as the place feels like the real home of Supercross. This will be the second of three visits to the venue in 2022, and the baseball diamond has been a busy place since the opening round. Don't expect this to be the same track as A1 in any way. The dirt has sat on the baseball diamond for weeks now and was subjected to a Monster Jam event, things that have dried out and beaten in the SoCal soil. The A2 track is beefy, with long rhythm lanes full of big jump combinations, multiple 180 turns, an elevated corner, 13 whoops, and a sand section. The final layout is slightly different from the rendering put out earlier in the week because the whoop pad before the sand section has been scrapped and replaced by a standard-sized triple. Conditions look to be much firmer and faster at A2, so the corners and transitions of jumps will develop much differently. Dirtwork soaked the track down and reworked the lanes after Friday's riding sessions in an attempt to lock in some much-needed moisture. Forecasted cloud cover on Saturday and cool temperatures will help the track from drying out, but that could also make the hard base even slicker when the night show starts. Three different winners in the 450 class and mixed finishes by the rest of the field has created the closest points chase in the sport's history. As we enter the fourth race of the season, the top 10 riders are split by just 14 points. Eli Tomac is at the top of the list with 59 points, Cooper Webb and Chase Sexton have 58 each, Justin Barcia has 56, Jason Anderson and Aaron Plessinger are even with 54, Ken Roczen and Malcolm Stewart are tied with 52, Marvin Musquin has 47, and Dylan Ferrandez 45. Christian Craig continues to hold the top spot in the 250 West Coast region over Hunter Lawrence and Michael Mosman. The Monster Energy Star Racing Yamaha rider had a close moment on Friday when he mistimed the longest rhythm section on the course, slid off the back of his bike, and flew off a berm at full speed and into an awaiting net. Fortunately, Craig was not injured in the incident, and after some repairs to his bike, he put in a limited number of laps and called it a day. Hunter Lawrence's consistency has put him second overall in the West Coast region and with 67 points to his credit, while San Diego main event winner Michael Mosman is now third with 62 points. Adam Cincirillo and Joey Savacci announced they will miss the remainder of the 2022 Monster Energy Supercross Championship due to knee injuries they sustained and worsened at the San Diego Supercross. Potential top 10 finishers in the 450 class, the two would now have a chance to get completely healthy before the start of pro motocross. Savacci has already undergone surgery to repair his torn ACL, and Cincirillo will take the time to heal his shoulder. Let's talk to some of the people in the pits at A2.
It's so sick to see you and Richard down here. Like, when I saw you guys at Anaheim 1, I was like, yeah, that's cool. And then you made that post after Anaheim 1 just reminding him, like, soak this in, because to do this as a racer is the dream. You know, to do it as a young guy that's faced the challenges that Richard's faced in the last few years, these injuries and stuff. How is it to see your kid enjoying everything right now?
Yeah, it's really cool. You know, the main thing is, you know, he works so hard at it and he's so passionate about it. So that makes me, you know, really want to sort of help him. He hasn't had the greatest results yet, but we had some issues the first couple rounds and he's close. And, you know, I got to just keep remembering how tough it is. Like, you know, it was a while ago when I did this and I kind of forget. So when he doesn't have the results that I sort of expected, I was like, oh, and then I had to remember, man, everybody out here is so freaking good. You know, these guys are so fast now. And you know, just the tracks and everything about it is quite a bit different. So it's cool, and I'm just stoked for him. You know, I really am. It's of course I'm his dad, but I'm pretty pumped on how he's doing and what he's been doing. So yeah.
It's like one of the highlights of my weekend when I get to see you guys. It really is. I think it's so sick. Switching to the business side of things, really cool the deal that you guys have worked out with X-Brand. You know, it just keeps growing. Everything keeps going. New goggles. You have it on more guys. You're really like the official goggle of these top main event privateers. So how is it to just keep progressing, especially in something so competitive as goggles right now?
Yeah, you know, again, it's tough, you know, and business in general, you know, is hard. The motorcycle industry, our biggest challenge right now is just getting product. I'm sure you hear that from everybody. Every company out there is, you know, all the people watching this probably try to order something and it's out of stock from any company, and it just all has to do with the supply chain and getting stuff from overseas and containers, and like it's real. Like you know, it's incredible how long the littlest stuff takes to get here now. So that's been our biggest challenge. You know, our new Lucid goggle is pretty rad. Like people are pretty stoked on it. It fits well. The whole mechanism of how the lens changes is amazing. It's so easy, and it just, you know, it makes everything just that much easier. So we've been doing really well with it, and you know, like you said, we kind of pride ourselves on having sort of the top privateers in the country. You know, last weekend we had Brees, Noren, and Chisholm in the main event. They were like the three privateers in the main, you know, so it was pretty cool. And you know, that's sort of where we're at, and we just keep pushing forward and keep making it happen.
I'm enjoying what I'm doing, certainly, and you know, it really has been a spectacular year. And it's what I always say, like, all the time. It's like, listen, this, we always say, this is one of the years with the most parity. But this is, I truly believe, the year that you can make a fair case for way more riders of why they can win. Whereas years past, it's like, well, this guy can win, but it's going to take this for him to do it. That's not the case. So it's been a lot of fun. Great year to be a part of Supercross. I always tell people too, if you've never really watched Supercross, man, you're coming in at a great, on a great year. So that's it. Just rolling along, and I'm excited about the rest of the season. And that's it, man.
How tight the points are. Yeah. You know, top 10 guys split by that little. Yeah. You know, you were really good at saying the season doesn't start to this point.
Yeah.
Any advice for those guys that are in that metal? Hey, don't sweat it. Hey, you need to step it up pretty soon. Get ready to stake your claim. Or is it just got to play out?
Well, I think that, you know, certainly with how tight the season is this year and how close everyone is, I think it's really going to, it's going to be a positive for the guys that are mentally strong, because they have to be able to withstand so many different guys every single weekend, being fast and basically like race management and championship management. Instead of having, you know, two or three aces, now they got 7-8 aces. So that's what I think. And if I'm telling my guy that has the mental wherewithal to be a champion, it's like, hey man, you've got to be on. There's a lot of things that you got to manage, and I think that the guy that is strong upstairs is really going to shine in the field that we have, because they're all so close. So at the end of the day, you just have to believe in yourself and have that mental confidence and know that you can be there every single weekend.
Oh man, you know, it's definitely cool getting out here. It's different. I mean, I just want to go to every round, get my time in, have some fun, and you know, just come out healthy.
As a guy that, you know, has not a lot of Supercross experience, you didn't grow up out here, so it's not like you were putting in laps on a, you know, Lake Elsinore, State Fair, whatever track all the time. What are the expectations like in your rookie season?
This rookie season is just a learning experience, you know. Don't do anything too crazy. Stay where I'm comfortable and just get through it, you know. Definitely next year I want to come out swinging, but this year just, you know, have fun and just make it to every round.
Cool. Hey, you've had some changes in your program over these last few years. Cool to see where you're at right now. With this group and the people that you have around you, how did all of this come together?
Me and Mike were in contact, Duclos with Rock River. We were in contact for, you know, end of the year last year, and we ended up putting this together last minute, but I'm super grateful for the opportunity and, you know, really happy to be under their rig and repping for them for my rookie season this year, and just really grateful to have them behind me.
Okay, with 3 in, it's had its highs and lows so far. Where are you at after Oakland, San Diego, and A1?
Yeah, not been where we want to be overall, but yeah, I feel good on the bike. I feel like I'm riding good. I let one slip away last weekend. Should have had the podium, but yeah, I feel good. Just little mistakes are costing it, but yeah, we're working on the starts. We're getting them better, and that's the big key for me right now. And just trying to put it on the box this weekend, maybe fight for a win, and yeah, just see where it goes.
Okay, as an East Coast guy, how nice is it to be in Florida and kind of in familiar territory? You didn't have to go through that whole, I'm going to move to California and change my entire way of life.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, it's been nice this offseason. I didn't get to ride that much because I got hurt in the outdoors. So I haven't been on the bike like a ton. So we've been training out here right now for the West Coast swing. So we've been out here for probably four weeks, five weeks. And yeah, it's been nice. Florida's been awesome. East Coast from there, so it's kind of a familiar thing. So yeah, it's been good.
All right, hip injury, all that's good.
Yeah, shoulder.
Shoulder,
yeah.
Sorry.
No, you're good. Yeah, shoulder's good. Yeah, it's just now feeling like right at where I feel like it's back to 100%. It's been a long process, but yeah, it feels good. Just now trying to still work on the strength, but it's so hard. I mean, we're in season, so you can't do too much. You get too sore. So yeah, it's hard, but yeah, it's feeling good.
Was that one of them you had to get surgery on, or was it just let it heal and recuperate?
Yeah, I had to get surgery on it. I tore my labrum, so it was a long. It was like a 5 months process. So, yeah, and then after that, it's still not back to 100%. We did all the therapy we could. We put in all the work. Yeah, it's feeling good now, but I feel like right now it's right back to 100%. So we're just trying to work on strengthening it more, but, yeah, it's coming.
All right, so building from here.
Yep, thank you.
I was right there when you figured out that you had the points lead last week. Did you expect that after you crossed the finish line?
No.
Not at all?
Not at all. Nope. I mean, I knew we weren't that far out of the lead, but it was the last thing that was on my mind, and it definitely made me chuckle when I saw that, just because, like, how does 6.42 get into the lead, right, on the first three rounds? But it does this year.
Yeah. Watching you in Oakland and then watching you last weekend, man, you have this thing turning so well. How has that been to figure this out? Because so many people kind of still criticize this bike for its turning attributes, but you figured out how to make it handle it.
I don't know. I thought this thing turned great from day one, so I don't know. That's a testament to the other guys, to the guys on our team, for figuring it out and having a good base to start with. I've got no problem with turning. If anything, I can turn low on this bike. It's good.
Yeah, you underturned Marvin last week, and that says a lot on Marvin on that bike.
Yeah.
Like I said in that Yamaha Beyond the Track video, there's no guy that really rides a 450 as aggressive as you, and I think that's a really good attribute on this thing. After your time on it, does it feel like the harder you ride it, the better it is? Or is there a fine line?
It's a fine line, because it has some fire in it. You know, it goes. It's awesome that way. But I think it's totally rideable, and it's good. It's good.
Okay, I talked to Brad, and he said you're the only guy that he's ever heard ask for more power. So,
how do I... Oh, I know, it's pretty funny. They're like, dude, you're the first guy that has an Astra detuned map, and they're just like, they couldn't believe it. I'm like, no, dude, this thing just eats, and it's good, and I can control it with my clutch. It's good.
Okay, the last thing, you know, you moved to this thing because you wanted more change and you wanted to do all these things. Now that you're in it, how is it to go through that process again? To learn a new bike, to learn new people, an all-new mechanic. How has that been, and has it been what you expected?
There's only one.
At first I had a lot of questions, you know, and then it just turned into just an enjoyable process, an enjoyable time being around a good group of guys, good group of people. A bunch of new tracks and places, and going to Florida was a lot of fun preseason, and then back out here and riding with everyone and doing motos at the practice track. So I wouldn't change it for anything at this point, and like what we got going on.
You put your share of red plates on. What's it like to put on the 450 red plate? Is it a nice accomplishment?
Yeah, it's a great accomplishment. It's kind of like a different animal, you know. I mean, it's still early, so a lot can happen, but it's still a cool accomplishment for both me and Eli, so it's pretty exciting.
Was it a weird deal when you got bumped up to the 450 thing? I know there was a little bit of, like, who's going to do what within the team last year. For you to get that spot, honestly, that shows how much they trust you, because you've been here for a while.
Yep.
You were drawing a blank. Reardon's mechanic, even back in the day. You know, you've been here for a while.
Yep. Obviously it makes you feel good for them to offer it to me as well. And then it's just a different animal in the sense of you got twice the amount of rounds and you're working for one of the best riders in the world. So it is a great accomplishment.
What's it like to learn a new guy? You know Justin so well, but then to take all this on, hear different input, how the bikes will be set up, and then getting them to kind of trust your build technique.
Yeah, it's a process with a new guy, and we put a lot of time together in the off season, so it actually was a pretty easy transition, but it took a little bit.
How did that feel? We saw Rango do it the week before, and I know how pumped he was, so how was it for you?
It was amazing, everything you'd think it would be. I've won a lot of races in the 250 class, but there's nothing like getting that premier 450 win. It's something special.
Did it feel like those 26 laps took forever, or did they fly by?
Honestly, like, usually for me, it feels like it takes forever, but this time it was a little bit different. I don't know why, but I just felt calm and confident in Chase's ability, and And yeah, it wasn't that bad.
When he got into the lead that quickly on, does your messaging on the pit board change to him at all, or does it just stay the same, just lap times, gaps, reminders?
Yeah, basically just lap times in the beginning, and then when he started working a good gap, I just started putting the gap so he knew where he was, and he could ride accordingly, you know.
When I saw that trend last Friday, after press day got over and I was like looking at the dirt, I'm like, okay, two guys that this is going to benefit. It's going to be Jason or it's going to be Chase. Chase really because of how good his technique and his bike control is. How abrasive that dirt was, how hard packed. How was he on that rear tire?
I mean, it was, you know, he was definitely getting after it all day. And then we made the call before the heat to do a groove tire to kind of help with the hard pack condition, and then it was positive for him. He didn't get the best start in the heat race, but still he liked the groove tire, and we knew we were going to run that for the main also.
He seems like he's pretty, aside from your grip tape, because I got that shot,
yeah.
He seems like he's pretty easy on equipment.
He definitely is. The grip tape on the frame, it's pretty common for that to get worn out, especially on the left side for whatever reason,
shifting.
With the shifting, yeah. But yeah, he's not very hard on the bike. It's nice, and it's all with his technique and his style.
You get a bike, let's go.
Put you on the spot about those triple clamps.
Sure.
What is it that you guys are really finding, and what is it like for him to have that big breakthrough, like, hey, this part's going to give you the confidence?
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't put it all on the triple clamps last weekend. It was our first race with them. We made a lot of changes last week to just make him feel more comfortable on the track, help him be better in the whoops, and not everybody on our team is running them, but for him, it was one of the many things that made him more comfortable, and not just in one section of the track, but yeah, all over the track.
Eventful week for you last week.
Yep.
First, we got to talk about the on-track thing, just to get it dead and out of the way. What happened, and what's the process like for you guys with the AMA afterwards? From a team manager's perspective, you're obviously never pumped, but it's
right.
Your guy, so you got to handle it somehow.
Yeah, for us, it kind of sucked just because it was my second weekend in a row in there, because obviously Adam had that incident with Brees, and then, you know, the Justin on Justin crime. It was kind of tough because, you know, we don't condone what our rider did, but at the same time, you know, we want him to stand up for himself, and the other rider has a track record of doing that. So the process with the AMA was good. I think the new way they're doing stuff with J-Bone really helps a lot. He knows what he's talking about. He's been around the pits. Thule's been around a long time. Mike's a good guy. And I like the process. I don't want to be in there. Yeah, it worked good. We accepted what happened because Justin was for sure in the wrong. But we're glad he was able to put it behind him this week. We had a good week of practice, and we're for sure building. So.
Okay. I'm sure that was quite the thing to have happen when you have a lot of new sponsors. Like, you guys have three pretty important new partners this year in WD-40, Progressive, and then Home Depot and Select Races. So were you kind of like, oh God, or was it like, oh, here we go?
You know, there's nothing that you can do. It's not like I can go out there and ride the bike. So, I mean, definitely.
You could have. You could.
I couldn't have. But, you know, that's definitely not what we wish. We'd rather get the whole shot and, you know, have a good, clean race. But I'm happy that Justin stuck up for himself. He's had a super rough few weeks, and we stand behind our riders there, right, wrong, or indifferent. And, yeah, it kind of is what it is. We, you know, he had a good heat. He started good in the main, and he was starting to find his flow, which was good for us. And the first pass was a little unnecessary, and, you know, the second one, the retaliation was also unnecessary. So we're glad to have it behind us. We're glad the AMA came to a quick decision. And I hate that it says DQ. When I accepted it, I didn't really think that kind of backlash was going to happen, so I probably would have maybe appealed,
yeah.
But seeing it now, because the DQ doesn't look that pretty, but it is what it is. We're ready to move on and have a good clean race. Hopefully they don't find each other, and we're good.
Okay, bigger and better things.
Yeah.
Now that all that's done, it's in the past, tomorrow's a new day. How is it to bring in these new sponsors? You and I talked last year, the Twisted Tea thing has been,
yeah,
big in itself. Progressive is a huge deal.
Yep.
Motorcycle-minded company. WD-40 is making gains with their lubricants and everything that they want,
yeah,
to do. And then you get the Home Depot. So,
right,
bang, bang, bang. Three huge partners, mainstream things for a team like you that's completely independent.
Yeah. for us, it's just trying to make the sport better and just outreach the sport. And I think a lot of people are missing on what this sport does good. And we have a good demo. Our fans are crazy fanatical. And I think maybe just other people aren't tapping into that yet. And that's something that we've really, really tried to show our partners and our sponsors on, you know, what the fans of SX bring. And they do love their riders. They love their teams. And they'll go out and support the products that the riders, you know, that help pay the riders. And so that's a big thing. And, you know, for us, it's just with the Home Depot thing and stuff that we did with WD-40, that's just more of a B2B thing. We're still proof of concept there, and it went really, really good. And, you know, we're happy to say we're going to probably expand it this year and do a lot more. Our next one's in Daytona Beach, and that's during Bike Week, so we expect it to be big. We're happy to have Home Depot on board, even if it is just on like a smaller scale, and we hope to grow it with Home Depot and with WD-40 as well. So it's pretty neat to do some things. And you know, I will say, we did that thing on Sunday there, and the people that came by, they were stoked. So that's something cool to see, because the people that came by are just shoppers at Home Depot, right? So for them to be able to engage with the dirt bikes and go talk to the mechanics and dap up the riders, check out the team rig, it was a pretty big deal for them. So stuff that me and you might take for granted was pretty awesome to see. So I'm glad that we're going to do more.
We've got a lot more to come from Anaheim too, so be sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel, follow along on social media, and visit swapmotolive.com.